I would like to appreciate the organizers of this conference for giving me the opportunity to share a few things, especially among senior colleagues like Professor Tony Croft and Dr. Jenga and Professor Herman. I'm really humbled. I thank the KPA organization for giving those of us who are still growing an opportunity. So I'd like to share with us a few things about the mental health of healthcare workers during COVID-19. And some of the things I'll be saying are as a result of a study that we did. And so I'll be presenting on behalf of the co-investigators, amongst who is Professor Lukoya, who is a senior author. So as has been said, I want to not emphasize too much, but still remind us that healthcare workers are part of the general population. And therefore, when we talk about the effect of COVID-19 on mental health in the general population, we always must remember that healthcare workers are human beings. They come from families. So when the people are afraid of getting the disease, they are part of it. When there is unemployment, those are our spouses. When the children have been home and there have been conflicts about how to handle them, before we are called healthcare workers, we too are affected by such things. And therefore, we are at risk first for being human. And then the fact that we are dealing with the COVID-19 itself as frontline healthcare workers then adds to the burden and the risk of mental health. And there are a lot of studies that have documented already that to a great extent, COVID-19, like all other pandemics or epidemics, and the burden of mental health issues is actually great amongst healthcare workers. And specifically, many of us who've been around working in hospitals recently, you feel it when you go to hospital and you are not sure whether you will be well. And when you come back home, you must remember to tell your children not to hug you because you must shower. And sometimes the children don't understand. So that the ever increasing risk of infection that remains. And then there's a workload, and I've had the privilege to work as part of the task force for remote teaching and referral hospital. And I've had to work with staff who sometimes they are there, if it's nursing, they've had to work longer hours because you don't have the privilege of so many nurses that you can work a few hours. And especially initially they were stretched and you'd work more than 10 hours in a shift. Then there's an issue of protective equipment, and you've had issues. Is the quality we are receiving even good enough? Are they there? Should we be wearing N95? Is the surgical mask okay? Should we wear a surgical mask on top? And all these things likely affect us. Then there's the media coverage, a lot of information. Things have gotten better slightly, but if you think about it, especially when the COVID-19 began, there was a lot of information and scares, and watching tracks of bodies being transported to a mass grave. And we healthcare workers, we look at it and imagine that we'd be part of it. And especially we also watched healthcare workers narrating their stories about how overwhelming it was. I still remember one time watching CNN, and one of the nurses, the only thing they say is their experience can only be described as overwhelming dread. And of course, we have heard of suicides. We remember the American doctor who committed suicide, and I'm sure there are many other people who've suffered, and this has not been reported sometimes. There, the fact that there's no cure for COVID-19 and all the conflicts of whether we should be using chloroquine and whether vitamins are working, all this is conflicting information that all contributes to a healthcare worker's risk of actually being at risk of developing mental health challenges at this point. And of course, there are times, and we've seen even in our own country, where sometimes the healthcare workers have felt like they were abandoned, that there are expectations from the management and from the government. And one of the things I've been working with closely with even the nursing staff and the staff who are working in the isolation centers. And every time there's a mortality, people come down and they want to kind of harass you. Why did this happen? And sometimes it's totally overwhelming. And all these things have, of course, contributed to the risk that we could be at a higher risk of developing mental health. Of course, reminding ourselves that we are part of the general population and we have always been at risk, even before COVID, but the risk increases. And this is what informed something, the survey that we did earlier in May. We know that we haven't had a lot of research in Kenya helping us to understand the burden of mental health disorders amongst healthcare workers. So we put together a quick survey, and the aim of this survey was just to understand the common mental disorders that at the time that were being described as highest among healthcare workers, as anxiety, depression, use of substances, possible PTSD, and difficulties in sleep, and wanted to see what is the burden. We really would keep off the word impact because we hadn't had a baseline. So this was like the baseline itself, and wanted to know how big is this burden. And we also wanted to establish the associated factors of these mental disorders. So what we did is that we targeted all healthcare workers, nurses, doctors, public health officers at the time. And we developed a tool that we programmed the social demographic questionnaire, the GAD-7 for anxiety, PHQ-9 for depression, audit, and primary care PTSD, the 5 questions, and then the Pittsburgh Quality of Sleep Index, and put them all together into red cup, so, and put it in a survey. And we sent it out on Facebook, on WhatsApp, and email. And we also asked our colleagues to share these. Yeah? And what happened is that we of course, we wanted it to be a research, so we got approval from Moi Teaching and Referral Hospital, Institutional Ethical Committee, and we also got the approval from NACOSTI. And we have since analyzed the data using R, and we did some bivariate analysis and multivariable logistic regression, and we'll be sharing briefly. 10 minutes is too short to share everything, so it's really just a brief of what we are already finding as we continue to analyze the data. So we managed to reach 1,259 healthcare workers. However, as is expected in all online surveys, not everyone was able to complete the tool. So the response rate was 76%. And what we established is that there were very young people who were able to answer to this survey, and probably there are reasons as to why not everyone may be able to access some of these platforms. And it's important to notice that majority of those who responded were females, mostly married, non-specialist doctors. So that's the medical officers were the majority of those who responded to these questions. And most of them are working in public facilities, as you can see, 70%. And a majority of the respondents were working in level 6 facility. And it's also good to note that at the time, those who answered these questions didn't have a medical condition and they had never been treated for mental illness. So what did we find? I think, again, we say that we didn't have a baseline, so we assume this is the baseline. We found that about 5% of the healthcare workers in Kenya have severe depression, while about 10% to 11 have moderate to severe depression. Those are people who would actually require treatment. And when we look at alcohol use, again, 43%, which is a significant number, were actually using alcohol in a harmful manner. Of course, it's difficult to tell whether this has increased at the time. And then we look at generalized anxiety disorder, again, about 15 to 16% having severe to moderate anxiety that would actually require intervention, while about 20% had mild depression. Looking at the probable PTSD, having been exposed to some traumatic events and experiencing symptoms that resemble PTSD, it was surprising that 64%, that's about 2/3 of our participants, would actually report confidently that they had been traumatized at the time they were taking this survey. And as you can see, about 23% of those who participated had difficulties with sleep. And when we try to see what are the factors that are associated with these experiences, one thing that came out very strongly for all the categories is that young females who are not married and who had fewer years of experience had higher rates of depression, they had higher rate of anxiety, and they're also more likely to have difficulty in sleeping. Actually, the only thing that was slightly less in that category were the alcohol use disorder, which tended to be commoner in males, and those who are had more years of experience. I don't know whether it's because they feel a bit more confident that they can keep taking alcohol, or is it a way of coping over the years? Is that the reason why they are less, quote-unquote, less depressed and less anxious? So that's the only thing, but it's so striking that younger females who are not married, who had fewer years of experience, actually tended to be anxious. And this was also demonstrated when you did the multivariate logistic regression. And we noting that females were 1 to 1.5 times more likely to be depressed compared to male. And those who are married were, again, those who are not married, again, 1.5 times more likely to get depression. Very interesting. And being female was protective of alcohol use. Again, so we confirmed again that females younger and married were at higher risk, and especially those who didn't quote unquote have significant social support if you think of it from marriage. And we could go on and on, but in 10 minutes, it's difficult to describe everything. But one of the things that comes out clearly, clarifying again, we are not talking about impact here, we are talking about the burden that would be information that would be useful to guide any intervention, that there's a high burden of mental health disorders among healthcare workers currently responding to COVID-19. Very, very important. And the importance of that is that what we do now that we express increases, of course, we expect increases at this time. Of course, it's difficult to get the exact increment in terms of substance use, in terms of depression, especially because we are not able to reach the exact same people so that they can again repeat the survey. However, we expect, especially because that's what evidence is showing, that there are increases. There's a study that was done in the US, and they demonstrated that in the general public, people were more than 5 times more likely to drink during COVID-19 than they used to. And this is the same assumption we go with for healthcare workers. Therefore, it gives us a baseline for what is the burden right now, and it tells us to expect that it will be increasing, and helps us to plan for interventions, which is very, very important. However, as we analyze, as we look at these results, as we'll be sharing with this, we hope to actually publish and write a report, which we'll be sharing even with the Ministry of Health, is to keep remembering that being an online survey, there could be online biases because we don't know the people who actually answered. We see 77% response rate. What is the probability that those who answered have some differing characteristics with those who did not answer the question? That's one thing. And the other thing is, it's a cross-sectional study, and all the time we always must put caution that we cannot assume that a percentage of this could have been caused by COVID-19. So what then do we recommend? Given that we know that at baseline, many healthcare workers have a mental health issue and is likely to increase, we need to put measures to preserve and enhance resilience among younger professionals. And I think this has been done even at our own capacity as a teaching in the hospital. What we did is we kept training. Every time there was COVID-19 training, we had a section on mental health and psychosocial support. And I'd like to thank Dr. Njuguna and the Minister of Health, because this has really been emphasized. So we are not lagging behind too much. And even putting together what Dr. Njuguna and team call the mental health psychosocial support focal team. And this is what we've been trying to do, ensuring that people are being trained even for psychological first aid. And the other thing is, now that we've noted that younger professionals are the ones who are likely to be at risk, we are recommending that teams, other than what the ministry is doing, other than what counties is doing, even at institutional levels, teams must come together, of course, guided by their managers, to create opportunities for the healthcare workers to continue supporting each other and to identify when a healthcare worker is going down, and to be able to link them to care. I think that's the most important thing. And as I finish, to remind us that already there's a lot of work that is going on, and we'd like to thank Kenya Psychiatric Association, Kenya Medical Association, CPAC, and all the teams that came together. And of course, riding on the physician wellness program for Kenya Medical Association. And that's what Dr. Njega was talking about, the webinars that we are having every Tuesday, to keep reminding us that those are for us, they are not for other people. That's ourselves for ourselves, making sure that we are supporting each other. And to also thank all the healthcare workers who participated, and we look forward to sharing more information when we have the privilege of more time. Thank you very much, and if you would like to add